So that's pretty cool. So we have an upper bound that says that our algorithm is not going to take any longer than n squared k steps to explore a deterministic MDP. And a reasonable question to ask is that good or bad? And so what I want to argue next is that there's a lower bound saying that no algorithm can do better than n squared k, and therefore our algorithm's actually doing very well.
No, well, as well as one can do.
As well as one could do, right, which may not be well enough. No, and in fact, really, when you're trying to learn in these kinds of domains, you don't really want to make worst case assumptions. So this is under a worst case assumption where there's really no structure in the MDP. How many mistakes might we make en route to finding the optimal policy?
Okay.
All right. So let me draw a little MDP. So here's an MDP that we can call combination lock. So the basic idea of this is that we've got some kind of end state sequence and two actions, which I drew as purple and blue here. And each state has a purple action and a blue action. And one of them goes back to this reset state, this state number one, while the other one advances us up the chain one step.
I see.
And so we need to explore this whole thing, say, because there's some kind of giant reward over here, and every step that we're not making along this chain and then looping around here is a mistake. So the question is, how many mistakes might we make en route to finding this plus 100? So let's say we start off in this state number one. So what would RMAX do in this case, Charles?
It would pick one of them because they look the same.
Right. So it's in this state. It doesn't know anything about the outgoing actions, and it knows that there's purple and blue. So it picks one, and there's really no, you know, I tried to be kind of random about the way that which one would go forward and which one would go backwards. So there's really nothing you can do other than guess. If you guess wrong, then you take this blue action and end up back in state one, at which point you'd say, okay, well, I know what that does. Let me try the purple action. And now it advances us to the next state.
Right.
All right. So what happens from here?
Well, you don't know what's going to happen next, so you pick one of them.
Right. And so if we choose the purple one, we get reset back to the beginning, at which point we can kind of march up the chain and, you know, get back to where we have some unknown information and then try blue. But basically, each time we're exploring one of these states, it's taking us, well, if you think of it as state I, to explore state I, we take one action, which resets us back to the beginning, and it takes us I steps to get back to I, and then one more to get to the new state I plus one. So the total number of steps that we're taking here is going to be like 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 all the way up to n.
Right. That looks very n squarish to me.
Which is exactly right, which is n squarish, as some people say, right? So this total number of steps that we take, it's not literally n squared, but it's some constant times n squared. And you can't really do better than that. Now, in this particular case, we really wanted to prove a lower bound that was going to relate it to k times n squared, where k is the number of actions. Here, the number of actions was 2. Do you think the same example actually kind of scales up for greater and greater k? How would you change this example so that it would basically force us to do k actions times n squared?
Well, I can just make all but one of them send you back.
Yeah. Okay. So let's think about what that would do. So if we had k actions, one of them sent us forward and we have no idea which one, and all the other ones send us back to the beginning, then what's going to happen is we're going to have, each time we explore state I, we're actually going to get reset and have to take n steps k times.
Right.
Right. So for each of the n states, essentially, we're going to have to explore all the actions, and for all but one of them, it's going to be n steps to get back to where we are exploring again. And look at that.
Looks like n squared k, or k n squared.
Yeah, I just reordered it so that it looked more like the thing on the top.
You know, if you remember from our last machine learning class, everything got us back to k and n. And there you go.
Oh, nice.
It's all the same.
It's always k nearest neighbors, but in this case, it's not.
It's k farthest neighbors.
No. Well, yeah, I guess there's some truth to that, that each time we take an action that we don't know about, we're getting unlucky, and we're having to take a very long trail to get back to where we started. But no, I'm just saying k nearest neighbors is a particular kind of algorithm, and here we're just talking, we're not, n doesn't stand for neighbor here, right? It stands for number of states.
I prefer to think that n stands for neighbor in this case.
Great. Okay, then I think we've got this one under control. So that's the argument that I wanted to make there, is that that we really do have to take kn squared in the worst case in a deterministic MDP to figure out what's going on and stop making mistakes.
Yeah, and there's no way around it, because this is like a, well, it really is a combination lock. The way you draw it, it's a random binary string that gets you to the end. Unless you get extremely lucky, there's no way to figure out what it is without trying all the combinations, sort of.
Well, it's not all the combinations. So combination lock in some ways is actually not a great name here. So in particular, what makes it a combination lock is to make it across this whole chain of n things, you have to choose the right color in sequence. You have to choose, in this case, purple, blue, purple, purple, blue, 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 right? So you have to kind of crack the lock. In a real combination lock,
right,
if you get any of these wrong, at the end of it, you don't get to find out which ones were right and which ones were wrong. You get reset back to the beginning and you just have to start again. So you really end up taking like number of actions to the number of states.
Right.
Different combinations. Here, we're lucky enough to actually know, hey, the first I parts of our combination are correct, and we're just guessing the ith one.
So really, it's a sequential combination.
Yeah, which is not very secure from a I don't know, security standpoint.
Well, in particular, you can solve it in squared time instead of k to the n time.
Right, so n squared doesn't sound so bad if you're comparing it to k to the n.
Right.
But anyway, but the point is that we can't get around that. And so that's really what I wanted to do. So the next thing I want to talk about is combining this idea with the banded idea that we talked about earlier and get an algorithm for general MDPs.
Okay.